Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to warmly welcome you today to a very special lecture here in our planetarium. When we included the lecture entitled Space Pioneer Elon Musk in the program, we could not yet foresee what further activities by Elon Musk would affect us. You all have silly followed the discussion in the media about the Twitter takeover, and also the question of how far he is still interested in Tesla. But this evening the lecture should be about SpaceX and his space travel aspects. Musk is a personality who has already done a lot for space travel. I am pleased that in Stephan Mögle-Stadel we have an experienced speaker and an expert here, who is also working on a book project about Elon Musk. Allow me to say a few words about our speaker. He works as a journalist and as a history and geography teacher. He became known for his biography of UN Secretary General Dag Hammarskjöld, who was assassinated in 1961. Many years ago, as a conscientious objector, he did his civil service with the United Nations and then worked as a book editor for the two UN Secretary Generals Boutros Ghali and Kofi Annan. So he is very globally oriented, and it is not surprising that he is now dealing intensively with Elon Musk and his spaceflight plans. As director of the planetarium, I am very pleased that you are with us today, Mr. Mögle-Stadel, and I would now like to invite you onto the stage.
Dear visitors of the Planetarium Mannheim, welcome to the lecture titled Space Pioneer Elon Musk: How Astrophysics and Science Fiction Shaped His World of Ideas Early On. The photos, the video clips, the graphics, and the info text overlays will, I hope so, make it easy for you to follow the lecture, even if I don't pronounce every English word correctly. And, by the way, you will find the English manuscript of this talk at the website weltdemokaratai.de. 1 year ago I wrote an essay titled A Flight to Mars, with Elon Musk, for a German magazine called The Humanist. In the English language, flight means both flying with an airplane or with a spaceship, as well as running away, to Mars. So, why should we flee to Mars? Earth is slowly dying. This was once the headline of an essay by biochemistry professor Isaac Asimov, 1971, in the German Mirror, Spiegel, magazine. 1 year later, in 1972, the legendary Club of Rome report, The Limits to Growth, was published. Asimov warned of the dangers of overpopulation growth, environmental destruction, and suggested relocating at least some human beings to Mars before Earth is collapsing. In addition to his scientific non-fiction books, Asimov also wrote science fiction novels. Elon Musk has been among his readers since a young age. On the left side, in June 2003, one of Germany's news magazines ran the headline, Race to Mars. What was meant by this slash was a race between space probes and Mars rovers. NASA and ESA had long since slash stopped thinking about a manned mission to Mars. For the nation-state experts, manned spaceflight to Mars had become distant science fiction, as told in the movie Race to Mars. But then something happened that the state authorities did not expect. A genius mind appeared on the spaceflight scene and founded the private company SpaceX in June 2006. His visions were reusable, inexpensive spaceships, and a manned colony on Mars is his goal. Like Asimov suggested in his writings, our species, unfortunately only a small part of it deserves the honorary name of humanity, should establish offshoots on other planets, so that something good of us survives global catastrophes or a suicidal nuclear war. Here we see Elon Musk with one of his Falcon rockets in the background taking off. The Falcon rocket, a name which reminds of the ancient Egyptian god Horus, is based on the newly developed Merlin engine. The next generation engine Raptor flies partly on the basis of methane, which can be produced on Mars for return transport. And SpaceX has also reinvented the old three-man Apollo space capsule. Here Elon stands in front of the new Dragon space capsule. It now has room for 5 cosmonauts, a future version also for 7 astronauts, even when the guys will not fly ad astra to the stars with this Dragon. A reason why I prefer to speak modestly about cosmonauts. And this humble word is also closer to the necessary state of cosmic consciousness, the state of being a cosmopolitan. And we all should strive to become citizens of many worlds, a multiplanetary humanity. As Elon Musk promotes it, too. The Dragon space capsule is only a first beginning for the more advanced Starship to Mars program. For the film adaptation of the Marvel figure of the super-entrepreneur Tony Stark with his flying iron suit as Iron Man, his actor Robert Downey studied Elon Musk and his Tesla and SpaceX laboratories in several meetings and interviews. This led to Elon Musk making a guest appearance on Iron Man 2, where he spoke en passant with Tony Stark about Merlin propulsion and a new electronic spaceship drive. You will see this scene now in the following video clip.
Mr. Musk. How are you?
Congratulations on the promotion.
Thank you very much.
Elon, hey. Those Merlin engines are fantastic.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Yeah, good idea for an electric jet.
You do?
Yeah.
Then we'll make it work.
An Iron Man became Future Man. Elon, like Greta Thunberg, has a motivating function for the collective consciousness of our species. He stands not only symbolically, but also real technologically for overcoming the schizoid borderline disease. This divides our species into 200 competing nation-state egos, into Catholics and Protestants, Republicans and Democrats, U.S. Americans, Russians and Chinese. In the end, this fragmentation and waste of trillions of dollars in destructive weapons technology will lead to the self-extermination of Homo sapiens. We must free ourselves from this anti-evolutionary impasse. A humanistic-oriented colony on Mars can be an important first step in this direction. For this step forward, we need guides of a new humankind. Humans with nerves of steel, with ingenious engineering skills and a deep psychohistorical knowledge. And with a heart who beats for the future of humanity. In short, Homo humanus integralis cosmopoliticus. In this sense, it is correct that Der Spiegel referred to Elon Musk as an extraterrestrial, in German, Der Außerirdische, on one of its title covers. Seen on the left side of the slide above. Musk is not only known as a genius, with an ingenious progression form of Asperger's autism, like Greta Thunberg. But with his degree in physics, focusing engineering sciences. And a second degree in technological business administration, as well as an almost photographic memory and his talent as a programmer and inventor who really wants to bring super-AI machines and humans to Mars, he seems indeed a bit extraterrestrial. On the left side of the slide you can see a movie poster about another mathematical genius, the man who was able to calculate infinity, the Indian cosmopolitan Srinivasa Ramanujan. The evolution of mankind is also based on the efforts of many ingenious minds such as Elon Musk, Albert Einstein, Albert Schweitzer, Bertha von Suttner, Eleanor Roosevelt and Dag Hammarskjöld. Years ago, I already had written the German standard biography about this other extraterrestrial, which is available at the bookshop in the bistro area of the planetarium. Its title is Dag Hammarskjöld, Visionary for the Future of Humanity. The Nobel Peace Prize winner Dag was from 1953 until his assassination in 1961 UN Secretary General. He prevented in 1955 the outbreak of a war between USA and China. He ignored in 1956 in the Suez Canal crisis the veto in the UN Security Council and invented the UN Blue Helmets peacekeepers, which were not provided for in the UN Charter. He was regarded by the media at the time as a kind of prime minister of an imaginary world citizen government and said about his independence as a cosmopolitan between the Western and Eastern blocs, "Of course, I started from Sweden. But after I have reached my orbit as UN Secretary General above the international struggle, I no longer get too close to any nation." End of citation. You see, as a biographer and author, I am used to high flyers and extraterrestrials. Especially since the biography of Hammarskjöld has many parallels to that of Musk. Not only that they are both loners who were mobbed in their childhood because of their father's activities. Dag was murdered on behalf of the owners of the mining company Union Minière du Haut-Katanga close to Lake Tanganyika, where later on Errol Musk was co-owner of another mining company to which he took his son Elon for visit. Dag and his UNO team tried to create a real humanity organization. After Dag had failed due to the resistance of the psychopaths of his time, we now have a second chance through Elon to initiate an offshoot of a future humanity at least on Mars. Well, if SpaceX succeeds in keeping nationalists, bureaucrats, and religious enthusiasts away from Mars. First of all, we need a humanity-programmed super-AI on Mars. And then scientifically and humanitarian-oriented survival artists. A little bit with the heart of Howard Wolowitz as we can view in the next video clip.
You gotta be kidding me.
Sorry?
You're Elon Musk.
I am?
What are you doing here?
I'm washing dishes. Well, I was on the turkey line, but I got demoted for being too generous with the gravy.
Oh, man. What an honor to meet you. I'm such a fan of Tesla and SpaceX, all your companies. Howard Wolowitz, Caltech.
Nice to meet you, Howard. It feels great to come down here and help the less fortunate, huh?
Oh, yeah. Nothing better than helping people. Which is something I realized when I was viewing Earth from the deck of the International Space Station, where I spent 2 months as a payload specialist, a job I was qualified for because I'm an MIT-trained engineer.
And I thought I ladled the gravy on thick.
Sorry, it's just, you're you. I really want you to adopt me.
Well, you're here on Thanksgiving, so you're probably a good person.
Oh, I made my wife come down, too.
You think you might ever get back out to space?
Is that a job offer? Because I really want to go to Mars.
Let's look at what Elon Musk has achieved so far in a graphic of his corporation's network. He started with Zip2 and with X.com, later named PayPal, where he developed basic functions himself. After selling these both companies profitable, he founded the three central companies, Tesla, Solar City, and SpaceX. Supplemented by the civil engineering enterprise, The Boring Company, by OpenAI, by Neuralink and further companies that can be helpful for future space exploration. Not included in this graphic are his foundation and the Ad Astra School, a kind of scientific technological private school for future space children. As far as I know, they do a very good job there. The following video clip from the TV series, Young Sheldon, shows a highly gifted 9-year-old, as was Elon Musk, who, as a slightly autistic loner, teaches the NASA speaker better in school lessons about spaceflight science.
We can set out to explore the solar system. We've got a few minor problems to overcome, not the least of which is every time we launch, it costs the U.S. taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars.
Oh, no.
Yes.
If you want to save money, why don't you land the booster rockets instead of letting them drop in the ocean?
That's a cute idea, but it's not technically possible.
Why not?
Well, it's hard to explain. The math is pretty complicated.
Perhaps I could help you with it.
I bet you could.
Elon also gave the adult world an early lesson in programming when he created a video game with BASIC as a barely 12-year-old. He sold Blaster for $500 and the journal, PC and Office Technology, published the ingeniously simplified program code and praised the young genius. In Blaster you have to destroy an alien space transporter, which has hydrogen bombs on board to destroy humanity. Well, Elon was on his way early on to save humanity. On the left, the cover of Stranger in a Strange Land. Written 1961 by one of the authors Musk read, and liked, as a teenager, Robert A. Heinlein, an aeronautical engineer, naval officer, and pioneer of hard facts science fiction with often social critical depth. Elon, too, is a stranger in a strange land from an early age on. A stranger in the land of a world society, which in its insane normality and conformity was about to destroy itself. As Joseph Conrad once wrote, we are drifting into the heart of darkness. Elon grew up in South Africa, a country that had fallen apart into apartheid. As an exceptionally gifted child who was hardly understood by the others. The novel tells the story of Michael Smith, a human who comes to Earth after being born on Mars and raised after the death of his parents by Martians who live in the underground. He returns into a post-Third World War United States, where organized religions are again too politically powerful. As an heir to his parents, he is extremely rich. But more important, through his childhood and youth on Mars together with the PSI-gifted Martians, he has acquired extraordinary mental powers. Michael starts a Martian-influenced Church of All Worlds to heal the insanity of Homo sapiens and to help the species to become one humanity. He is killed by a mob. But through his training on Mars, he can maintain his quantum consciousness field, some might say his soul or his mind, after the death of his body. In Buddhism, this is called the Tulku principle. Michael has an older mentor on Earth named Jubal Harshaw. A similar figure is later found under the name S.R. Haddon in the cosmological novel Contact, written by Carl Sagan. Another book by Heinlein is entitled Podkayne, Citizen of Mars, published in 1963 and later read by Elon. The book is a first-person narrative consisting of the diary of Podkayne Fries, a 15-year-old Earth girl living now on Mars with her parents and her specially gifted 11-year-old brother Clark. Because of the unscheduled birth of their three test tube babies, in vitro triplets like Elon and his first wife Justine Wilson got, Podkayne's parents cancelled their trip to Earth. Podkayne flies alone with her brother on a large spaceship to Earth. On the way, Clark defuses an atomic bomb on board. This goes in the direction of the blaster video game programmed by Elon. Podkayne ends up fighting terrorists who want to destroy the independency of Mars to Earth, partly as a result of her brother's carelessness. At the end, the genius but partly autistic Clark shows human compassion by regretting his inability to cry. But becoming a true citizen of Mars would be only a first cosmopolitical beginning. Aeronautical engineer Heinlein published in 1957 the book Citizen of the Galaxy. The novel begins with Thorby, a defiant orphan boy who was bought at a slave auction by a seemingly scrap collector and universally educated in his deep underground domicile. After the murder of his foster father, who was fighting against a new kind of slavery, or apartheid, in the galaxy, Thorby is adopted by a free trader's ship clan who's traveling from planet to planet. Thorby, who is also technologically highly gifted, saves the spaceship Sisu and his new clan family by destroying a pirate ship. This, too, goes in the direction of the blaster video game. Thorby is at last identified as Thor Bradley Rudbeck, the long-lost heir of the very powerful Rudbeck Interstellar Enterprises network. Thorby returns to the cosmic enterprise of his parents and launches a proxy contest to win the control over the industrial network again. Knowing that a person can't run out on his responsibilities, he decided to fight the labor slave trade as the head of Rudbeck Industries. As in many of Heinlein's books, the gifted principal character grows in wisdom and knowledge by learning quickly from experiences and using their special abilities to resolve consequently problems, those of their own and those of the world society. Heinlein also wrote books about the terraforming of Mars and the cosmopolitical problems the Martian settlers will have with corrupt Earth bureaucrats. Red Planet is a 1949 novel about two of the students at a boarding school on Mars, Jim and Frank. It was the first appearance of Heinlein's spiritual elder race of Mars. Jim became friend of a furry creature with the size of a basketball. He mistakenly believes that Willis is some kind of an animal. On the trip to the boarding school, it turns out that Willis is the childhood form of a later highly intelligent Martian. Along the way, through Willis's mediation, the boys participate in the Water Brotherhood ritual of growing together. So they become water friends of the Martians, a kind of interspecies blood brotherhood. The two Earth bureaucrats, the new director of the boarding school Howe and the Earth administrator of the Martian colonies Beecher, plan not to supply any longer the thermal protection domes for the colonists, and other negative measures. With the help of Wills, who overhears a conversation between the two with his audiographic memory, the boys escape the now more military-conducted boarding school. On the trip to their parents' faraway outpost, the harmless-looking Martians reveal to them that there exists an ancient, hyperfast deep underground railway system, like Hyperloop. In this way they reach the colonial outposts in time to warn them of the conspiracy of the Earth bureaucrats. The Martians aid the earthly settlers against the officials of the fascistoid Earth governments. These guys are dematerialized or expelled from Mars. The transnational Mars settlers have to pass a kind of Turing test and then get a residence permit for Mars. A kind of humanistic brain drain to Mars. Similar conflicts figured 1950 in Ray Bradbury's The Martian Chronicles. Events in the Chronicle include the apocalyptic destruction of the Mars and Earth civilizations, both instigated by U.S. nationalists and flu-sick emigrants. After the last remaining wave of emigrants has reached Mars, the internationalistic world on Earth perishes in a global nuclear war. Here I have summarized just a few ideas in short sentences that may have accumulated in Elon Musk's consciousness and subconsciousness through intensive reading of such science and fiction books, which are a kind of quantum information or, as it was called in ancient India, Akasha Chronicles. I may remind you of Elon's flashes of light and faint-like absences in childhood and adolescence. This is how the ancient yoga texts describe the kundalini effects of an intense satori contact with the universal quantum ocean field. World citizen and dive school owner Arthur C. Clarke. Another science and fiction author that teenage reader Elon Musk has come across. In his tetralogy, Space Odyssey, he describes, among other things, how the Indian ITI therapist Dr. Chandra heals the supra-AI house disorder slash caused by irrational human paradoxy. Chandra, whose name includes the Chinese word Chan for Zen Buddhist mediation, summarizes his approach in the sentence. U.S. astronaut Bowman attempted to use brute force against Hal. I was cautious to use ahimsa in my negotiations with Hal. Ahimsa is the Sanskrit word for non-violence and is close to the Chinese concept of Wu Wei. In the following video clip we see Elon Musk briefly sitting in the audience of the Evolve Future conference in the movie Transcendence. The film deals with the subject of an artificial intelligence researcher who, after a poison attack by Christian military fanatics, uploads his dying consciousness into the internet and thus becomes a super-AI.
Intelligenz zu entwickeln, haben uns nicht nur bedeutende Fortschritte auf dem Gebiet der Neurotechnik gebracht, sondern auch in unserem Verständnis des menschlichen Gehirns. Zwar konzentrieren sich noch einige auf den weit entfernten Traum eines denkenden Computers. Ich glaube aber, der Weg ist viel wichtiger als das Ziel. Mein Fokus liegt darauf, die dabei gemachten Erkenntnisse meiner Kollegen zu nutzen, um neue Methoden für die Krebsfrüherkennung zu entwickeln. Und ich hoffe, ein Heilmittel gegen Alzheimer zu finden. Einfach ausgedrückt, Leben zu retten.
The before-mentioned Isaac Asimov has next to his four basic laws programmings for good AI also written about organizing the rebuilding of human civilization after a global collapse. In his Foundation novels, he describes the emergence of an official future science foundation of futurologists and psychological historians, the psychohistorians, who advise the leaders of the world of states and try to influence the course of history through mass media events. Like the Club of Rome, they are not very successful in doing so. But Asimov also designs a second, unofficial foundation of slightly psi-talented elite psychohistorians, who actively influence certain important people, history makers, at certain, kairos, points in time. This is where Isaac, whom I was able to get to know personally, used the idea of the Office for Strategic Services, short OSS. From June 1942 to September 1945 the OSS was the intelligence agency personally initiated by President Roosevelt slash to gather important information, analyze world politics, and conduct psychological and journalistic warfare. On September 20, 1945, President Truman signed Executive Order No. 9621 ending the OSS. There were too many freethinkers and cosmopolitans among the OSS officers and analysts. They wanted a more manageable secret service. The CIA was formed. Among the OSS staff were John Ford, Arthur Goldberg, Saul K. Padover, Arthur Schlesinger Jr., Ralph Bunche, Heinrich Wieshoff and Andrew Cordier. At least the last three worked for the UN from 1945 and served under Dag Hammarskjöld in his inner circle. Weishaupt, who fled Nazi Germany in 1936, died with Dag in a plane crash in Africa in September 1961. But back to the psychohistory of Asimov's foundation idea. There is actually a small social science discipline called psychohistory. Its best-known representatives were the psychiatrists and psychoanalysts Robert J. Lifton and Erik Erikson. If you want to preserve the seeds of a new beginning away from the turmoil of a collapsing world society, you should do so far enough away from the world wars. It is a highly intelligent idea to place a positive super-AI on Mars, as well as the genetic code of some outstanding humans, maybe even some frozen female ova and male sperm. You don't need a large human settlement for this. After an total collapse of the unfortunately in their majority rather nationalistic, greedy, and religiously fanatical insane majority of Earth population, one can then start from Mars after a while with the repopulation of the partially devastated Earth. A re-terraforming of the Earth. With a then hopefully more reasonable human species and an educational program for ecological world citizenship, possibly under the supervision of a philanthropic super-AI. In my work as a high school history teacher, in addition to writing books and leading psychological seminars for adults, I sometimes used SF literature to increase the plasticity of my students' thoughts. Quite a few sci-fi writers have had a slightly precognitive ability to forecasting upcoming events and developments. Read, for example, Fritz Lieber's deeply socio-psychological story, Sanity, in 1944, in which he predicted the coming in 1953 of such a UN Secretary-General as Dag Hammarskjöld, and his elimination by the psychopaths in the power centers of governments and colonial industrial corporations. One of the best-known pioneers of futurological forecasting was H.G. Wells. I recommend his 1933 work, The Shape of Things to Come. He predicted, among other things, the atomic energy age, a supership with the name Titan. And it's sinking by an iceberg many years before these things actually happened with the Titanic. He saw like a seer even the development of the atomic bomb many years before it really happened. And the necessity of a world citizens' government as the solution to deal with this new power. His four works, The Outline of History, 1920, The Open Conspiracy, 1928, Science of Life, 1929, and Wealth and Happiness of Mankind, 1932, were all designed to popularize the idea of creating a federal world state. In his view, this was the only alternative to a return to barbarism and ultimate annihilation. As early as 1985, in a U.S. Senate hearing in Washington, D.C., Professor Carl Sagan warned of the coming climate warming, which we should correctly call global heating. One of the politicians present, Senator Al Gore, understood the warning very well. By the way, you can find more information on our website weltdemokratie.de and in the manuscript of the lecture. Carl Sagan was testifying at a Congress hearing in 1985 on climate change. The whole subcommittee hearing on greenhouse effect and global climate change took place on December 10, 1985, including statements by Senator Al Gore after listening to Professor Carl Sagan and other scientists, who are warning about this phenomena very much. Well, the 1985 warnings didn't do anything. His critique of the political ignorance and the religious superstition of too many people, disguised as a sci-fi novel, was released that same year. In Contact, SETI project director Ellie Arroway, a modern-day Hypatia character, must stand against stupidity, nationalism, and ill-minded masculinity. Since real cosmic and cosmopolitan intelligence can only be found, at this moment of psychohistory, within a few humans on Earth, Ellie listens with radio telescopes. In search for extraterrestrial intelligence, in brief SETI, into the vastness of space. On page 446, German edition, Sagan briefly clarifies, citation, the only open question is that of intelligent life in the Politburo and in the White House. Our planet is ruled by madmen. End of citation. And because our planet is ruled by too many insane men and women elected to positions of power by too many idiots, smart extraterrestrians have no reason to contact us. If the ETs are watching our news and entertainment programs broadcasted into space, this mixture of war, violence, pornography, and talk show silliness, why should they want to contact us? Especially since the ETs could probably be a highly developed AI civilization. Should Homo humanus integralis cosmopoliticus, Homo HIC, the more intelligent part of this species, succeed in establishing a site on Mars together with positive super-AI, then this would rather be the place of an encounter. And not an Earth ruled by heavily armed and self-destructive fools. At the end of contact, the technological genius, the IT billionaire S.R. Haddon, travels alone with his sophisticated spaceship onto the journey to the stars. He's fed up with the Homo sapiens species. Could this be the future fate of an aging Elon Musk? Dear friend, I would like to accompany you. Well, but before this, Elon saves the depressed Tony Stark Iron Man in space with his Advanced Falcon spaceship. As we will see in the following video clip.
Take us about 100 meters away from the ship.
Okay.
Hey, Tony.
Bruce.
Where are we, upstate?
Buddy, you're in space.
Who's speaking?
Lavin is correct, and clearly the smartest among you.
Thor.
Good idea for an electric jet.
Who are you?
I think it's quite fundamental. I
mean, what?
It's just as fundamental in rocketry as it is in other forms of transport.
Yeah, we don't really need to start a conversation. Here's what I need.
I want an American cheeseburger.
If you've got a rocket that can be fully and rapidly reused, it's
somewhere on the order of 100-fold cost reduction.
Yeah, we'll talk about it later. Can you help a brother out?
You know, you really shouldn't talk that way to your captain.
All right, just get over here, please.
Cheeseburger first.
The cheeseburger joke wasn't the smartest. One more reason to leave the Earthlings. The majority never understood what the limits of industrial cancerous growth really meant. It was a spiritual call to renounce the total ego expansion at the expense of all other life forms. Such an achievement of renunciation would have been a genuine achievement of higher consciousness. In the German language, this is a psychological play on words. Wurzigsleistungen sind ich Leistungen. Instead, we consuming and amusing ourselves to death, as sociologist Neil Postman, who previously worked as an elementary school teacher, wrote in the 1985 book of the same name. We are destroying our perception for existential responsibilities through the primitive desire for consumption and pleasure fueled daily by the mass media industry. Through infotainment, overstimulation, and animated fun social activities, we pollute our inner world and nerve system. We waste our time and we overload our brain like a dustbin with stupid garbage. By doing so, we kill the higher potential of our neuronal network, which becomes neurotic and insane. There is a zombie point of no return for most of such silly media drug consumers. And at the end, our brain becomes a useless skull. The collective neurosis and the borderline mental illness lead to paranoia and anxiety disorders in many people. They then, projecting this fear onto scapegoats such as robots and super-AI, among other things. After all, in such primitive movies as Terminator, Skynet AI was a weapon system created by the US military-industrial complex, which then turned against its creators. So, is the super-AI now to blame or its murderously predisposed programmers? Maybe not the AI is the problem, but too many of us are mentally the problem. Albert Einstein gave a lot of talks in this direction. Some you find collected in the book Einstein on Peace, 1968, Schocken Publishers, New York City. The real danger is the deadly stupid war programming of AI. Stephen Hawking and Elon Musk together warned about it. In January 2015, Stephen, Elon and many AI experts signed an open letter on artificial intelligence calling for research on the impacts of AI. The letter affirmed that society can reap great potential benefits from AI, but called for concrete research on how to prevent certain potential pitfalls like misusing AI for automatical weapon systems. With OpenAI, DeepMind, Neuralink and Tesla bots, Elon Musk and colleagues show that AI can also be used very constructively as a human aid and partner. The Tesla bot, also known as Optimus, is a proposed general-purpose humanoid robot, who was presented at Tesla AI Day in October 2022 as a prototype. If Elon is seriously willing to establish a small colony on Mars, then he will send in at a first wave with Starship stuff such as 3D printers, Boring Company equipment, and Tesla bots to Mars. They will create underground laboratories, housing, and working facilities. Perhaps they will use existing natural or very old artificial cave systems for this. AI and robots will produce water and fuel long before the first humans get there. In the second wave, a handful of generalists and survival specialists will come with a one-way ticket to support the AI and the robots in doing special things beyond the current capacity of the AI and the Tesla bots. Normal scientists and technicians will only arrive on Mars in the third wave. This step-by-step plan makes sense. Our world is haunted by demons like nationalists, religious fanatics, the military-industrial complex, paid killers, paranoia, war hysteria, and so on. Only science, enlightenment, deep psychology education, and true human behavior in service of humanity is a candle and a searchlight for our survival in the future. Basically, it will be crucial to pay attention what kind of people we send to Mars. We shall ensure that they will be cosmopolitically minded humans like Elon, Gwynne Shotwell, Josh Don, Tom Zhu, Thuji Khan, Hans Konigsmann, Kong Yue-Wei, Eleanor Roosevelt, Dag Hammarskjöld, Carl Sagan, and Dru Yen, and many others. As a teacher with deep psychological experience and founder of the school project Globalization and World Citizenship Knowledge, within the framework of the Very Small World Citizen Foundation, I know that the practical humanities hardly finds any place in the old curricula. But jnana and kundalini yoga, Zen Buddhist meditation, psychoanalysis, neurolinguistic programming, and psychohistory are crucial training criteria for a holistic human mind. They also serve to increase resilience and mental strength in stressful situations. With our limited resources, they should at least be taught to the pupils who want to become future Mars emigrants. Even if actually all children in this one world should have a right for access to it. Let's add to this a training in three-dimensional chess, Tai Chi, and visual symbolic communication, as you will find indicated in these two photos. Take a deeper look at the details at the photo on the left. The details including messages to the subconscious. On the right-hand side, at a Club of Rome seminar, I visually demonstrate reaching a tipping point and a breakdown situation by piling up glasses on top of each other and let them toppling as a symbol for our consumer tower deconstruction. There is physical movement in the classroom and the amazing sound of breaking glass. Both will act as triggers in the subconscious of the students for a long time. Then we can talk about the limits of industrial growth and the mindless release of CO2 in the spirit of the Club of Rome. How far can we still play the game with overconsumption and environmental pollution? How tall can we still build the industrial tower? What is still possible in terms of constructing fragile consumer worlds before megalomania reaches the tipping point of collapse? The higher we build our skyscraper, the more substance we consume without a circular economy, the more we brilliantly accelerate entropy through stupid and wrong technologies, the more unstable our industrial world becomes. And now it gets exciting, we are approaching the climax of my talk. Perhaps we will be able to absorb and delay the collapse a little more technologically. But if we continue as before, then sooner or a little later our world city of glass will fall over the abyss of the limits of overload and overheating. That would be a shame and also the end of our imposture. Yes, you laugh. Still, but if things go stupidly with the destruction of the environment, with the littering of our planet, with the coming resource wars, with the heating of the earth, the millions of environmental refugees and nuclear weapons, then we end up like this broken glass. The Spiegel, a magazine co-sponsored by Bill Gates, would love to do a deconstruction of Elon Musk. In the January 2023 issue, the editors oracles about the so-called self-destruction of a superstar because of the Twitter problems. Very perfidiously, through photomontage, they gave Elon Musk a hairstyle from the 1930s of the Nazi era. Especially the small-minded Spiegel editors are known for always knowing everything better and not being able to do anything better. similar to their Nazi grandparents. The self-destruction they would like to attribute to Elon is actually the process of our world's self-destruction, including such people working at Spiegel magazine. In my new book, The Borderline: Collective Self-Destruction, An Answer to the Club of Rome, I show, among other things, such dynamics in which people and nations shift their own shadow onto others. It also includes some thoughts on Elon Musk, Supra AI, and the Mars Project. Take a look inside, maybe we'll see each other again at another lecture. Thank you for the gift of your attention.
The questions from the audience following the lecture and the answers of the speaker Mr. Stephan Mögle-Stadel can be found in the German video.